Hello everyone and welcome to Lutra TV. I'm Jonathan Church, Principal Process Engineer at Lutra.
And I'm Amanda Slater, Senior Process Engineer at Lutra.
And today we're going to be talking about chemical optimisation. We obviously use a lot of different chemicals in the water treatment process for various reasons, removing organics, turbidity, adding chlorine, sometimes adding fluoride for dental health, adjusting pH.
Adjusting alkalinity.
Removing water from sludge.
Assisting with process effectiveness, yep. I suppose would be a way of putting it.
And various other things. Most treatment plants, I guess, have at least a couple of chemicals that are used. But the question always is it being used effectively? When it comes to things like chlorine, you obviously want to target a certain range of that chemical. But for other things like coagulation and pH correction, how do you actually know that you're getting your bang for buck?
So I guess, like you touched on, there's some chemical additions that really there's not much you can do to optimise it, right? Because you're just hitting a flow rate with a dose. There's very little you can do. But the application that springs to mind when we think about how to optimise chemical dosing would be the coagulation, flocculation, filtration process.
Yeah, I mean, it's very typical of treatment plants that the amount of coagulant and polymer that's dosed needs to be adjusted given the raw water conditions, because obviously if there's more to remove, you need to add more chemical to remove it. But yeah, in terms of getting the right amount for how much you want to remove, there's a lot of different things that can be at play.
Yeah, and I suppose the instinctive response to a change in your filter performance would be, oh, we'll just put some more coagulant and we'll put some more polymer in. But there's got to be a sort of a smarter way of doing it, right?
So yeah, I mean, it might sound like a bit like witchcraft, but the dosing of chemicals has got a bit of magic to it in terms of getting the right amount at the right time for the right reasons. So, yeah, I mean, in terms of coagulant and polymer, typically you're adding them to remove your turbidity and your dissolved organics. So if I wanted to optimise the dose of a coagulant, I'd want to know that the amount of chemical that I'm adding is actually achieving the removal of turbidity and organics that I want. Organics, of course, are pretty easy. Like, you know, if organics are going through your filters or out of your clarifier after you've coagulated and it's too high,
something's gone quite wrong.
Yeah, something's gone wrong. It's not the right amount. That's pretty straightforward. Things like turbidity, especially when it comes to filters and clarifiers, can be affected by a lot more than just how much you're putting in. So one way to optimise coagulant polymer dosing is, of course, jar testing.
Yeah, so if your raw water quality has changed, you obviously want to know how it's changed and what dosing you need to do to fit that specific raw water quality.
So how would you do that in a jar test?
Yeah, that's the beauty of jar tests, right, is that we use a jar testing kit to simulate that water treatment process, the exact water treatment process that you've got with the exact raw water that you've got on a small scale.
Yeah, absolutely. And as you said, the key thing there is simulating the true process, because, you know, in terms of how much milligrams per litre or ppm of chemical you add is one thing, but the mixing energy, the time that it's exposed to the water, all of these things are critical in terms of performance. And to give an example, if say the mixing energy wasn't sufficient, you might end up with very large flocks that are, you know, float too much in your clarifier, or they break up when they get through a certain high energy system on its way to a filter, and therefore your turbidity suffers.
I've certainly spoken to many people about the importance of jar testing before, and yeah, I guess we can acknowledge that when you're in the middle of a weather event and things are happening on the plant, probably the last thing that your operator is going to want to do is to go out and take a raw water source sample and do jar testing. But you know, it's the most accurate way, isn't it, to establish what your optimal chemical dosing rate needs to be.
Yeah, and it's key as well to establish whether you can perhaps improve your chemical dosing, because if your jar test simulation is showing problems forming nice flocks, for instance, you might have a problem where you're not mixing sufficiently in an energetic enough way or for a long enough time to get the kind of flocks that you need for your membrane process or your clarification or your DAF or your direct filtration. Yeah, all of which usually results in people adding too much chemical rather than too little.
So on that note, are there any other ways that you'd be able to tell that maybe your chemical dosing rates aren't quite in the sort of sweet spot that you'd want them to be in?
If it's a question of coagulation or polymer, it's typically looking at the flock. And it's if you have filters or membranes, it's looking at things like the head loss across them. You know, a lot of this can be done by visually looking at what's going on. Clarifier is a classic example of if you see flocks floating up and out of your clarifier, that may mean you're adding too much coagulant, the flocks are too big. It might also mean, like I said, the mixing energy isn't sufficient, you know, the flocks are taking too long to form. Or it could also be indicative that perhaps, say, your polymer isn't high enough, or equally that it's too high.
And you get that lovely polymer sheen across the top of your clarifier.
Yeah, so it's difficult. It's difficult to say, at least from a pure data perspective, apart from looking at things like the turbidity out of the process. So, you know, investigating it in person is always worthwhile.
So it's becoming really familiar with your plant and your process and knowing what's normal and what's not.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, and at least when it comes to other chemical processes, you know, pH correction, things like that, obviously it's straightforward in that you want to hit a certain pH set point. But the question is more, is that the right set point for your process? And, you know, things like coagulants, obviously, they work in a certain pH range. Basically balancing out the acidic effect of coagulants with the pH correction means that you can compound the amount of chemicals. If you're overdosing coagulant, then you may also end up overdosing.
Compensate in another way.
With a caustic or lime system. So the savings can really add up.
So if we're getting away from, say we want to, rather than speaking about optimizing your coagulant, your polymer dosing, if we are looking at a plant where we're using, say, CO2 and lime, for example, to balance your pH and your alkalinity, what are some of the things that we could look at to optimise that?
Yeah, so that's a good question. And CO2 is obviously topical since the cost increases of it. And you may have a plant where the pH for coagulation, the coagulant dose are fine, right? But that becomes looking a bit further downstream. You know, are things like the aggressiveness of the water coming out of the plant too high or too low? You know, is the water at the right balance to stop concrete and the lines downstream degrading? Even if everything else is fine, you know. But changing that, even by a milligram a litre, might make a massive cost difference depending on the size of your plant.
So you have to take a really holistic view of your entire treatment process and even your distribution systems downstream to understand what the impact of one small change could have.
Absolutely.
On everything else.
Yeah, and other places where a plant might see improvements is obviously in the sludge. So, yeah, and the sludge that is collected in a clarifier, a DAF, or on a filter in a backwash or a membrane in a back pulse, you know, all of these things are essentially a combination of the raw water turbidity and organics that you've precipitated out. You want to remove that, but also the solids from, say, the lime that you're adding, the coagulant that you're adding, possibly other things. And the more solids that you add, essentially, to remove those raw water characteristics may result in more sludge production, which is all well and good. But if the desludging on the clarifier is not set up correctly, then you may end up wasting water to get rid of sludge. So, yeah, optimising things so that, you know, you're not wasting water or chemical at the same time could be quite powerful.
Because I suppose then it would become a compounding problem where you're overdosing your chemical and your clarifier and then you end up having to dose more polymer in your dewatering system.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's say if you overdosed a coagulant by 10%, you effectively end up with a higher amount of sludge at the end of it that doesn't necessarily need to be there, and that needs to be disposed of. It might need to be settled, centrifuged, and dewatered. Yep. And equally, if you're, you know, adding polymer to your sludge to thicken it up and get a bit of sludge cake on a centrifuge or something like that, you know, not adding the right amount is going to result in a sludge where you're disposing more water to landfill than you necessarily need to be.
So would you say, looking at something like your overall chemical costs and your ongoing OPEX trends, your chemical consumption rates against your water quality data, like there's a lot of opportunity there to look at the data and the trends that you have to understand whether you're in the right space as far as your chemical dosing is going?
Yeah, I would say so. Because it all comes down to money in the end. And money also means CO2, really. You know, the amount of chemical that's shipped here from overseas, disposing of it on the trucks into the landfill, you know, all of this sort of stuff may not be fully thought about at the moment. But it will be soon enough, you know. So the focus at the moment is how much things cost.
Yeah.
And, yeah, if you're looking to save money, then really that's quite an easy place to start, is to get everything operating as tightly as possible because, yeah, it can definitely add up all the way through the plant.
Yeah. Well, thanks for that, John. That was a really interesting chat. It seems like there's a lot of areas where chemical optimization can be used to really improve the processes that you're running and save you money, which, you know, is better for everyone in the long term. If you need more help looking at your chemical consumption rates, feel free to give Lutra a call and we'll help out. Thanks.